chateau countryside of Limoges. And early on, as the field raced 159 miles from Poitiers to Charmey, a group of 10 escaped to pose more problems for the overall leaders. The ever-changing face of this race was again producing an unusual pattern. Group worked hard, building a lead of 9 minutes as the Limousin Hills began to wear down the field, tired from yesterday's time trial, that had put Charlie Motte in the leader's yellow jersey. But this was different now. Whereas Carrera chased everyone down this week, the System U team of Motte slowed the chase so that their team man up front, Marshall Gaillon, could gain time. It was to be another demonstration by System U of team strategy. Everybody watched Motte, so Gaillon took the initiative. The field were resigned to lose time, and the 7-11 team were also below par for the first time. Hampson drank at the back when perhaps he should have been at the front. And on this day, Jeff Bradley was being urged just to finish by teammate Ron Keeple. Raul Alcala also faced rehabilitation from Friday's crash in the time trial. Fortunes changed quickly in the Tour, but none quicker than for this man, Marshall Gaillon, who left the 10 leaders to win alone and take the overall lead away from his teammate, Charlie Motte. What a race this is turning out to be. But for some, it was all over. The opening 10 days has told on people like Bruno Wojcinek, a Frenchman who no longer will contest the sprint finishes he specialises in. His body cries enough, suffering from a back problem, and there's nothing you can do or say to help. And further ahead, Jeff Bradley and Bob Roll are also cast adrift, left to suffer in the desert conditions as they fall over half an hour behind. They suffer from sickness. What a difference a week makes in the Tour. The Tour de France is a heartless creature that provides every obstacle possible to man's success. In this hostile world, Bradley waits for Bob Roll, normally the strength of the 7-11 team. Now there's nothing to do but to go on. Bob Roll is ill, and there's no answer to that. Bob Roll was 7-11's highest finisher last year in the team's first Tour, and he carried Andy Hampson to victory in the Tour of Switzerland this year. For Bob Roll, it really shouldn't have to be this way. Like a waiting vulture, the broom wagon is ready for the moment no rider hopes will arrive. Finally, Roll abandons the Tour de France. Bradley joins him. To both of them now, the pain is over, but the memories will remain. At the finish, it's a happy smiling face of Marshall Gaillon. But for the 7-11 team, it's a moment of despair.
Bike race, though. It's a death march. Today's the first day of it.
And the march continues tomorrow into the Pyrenees, where the mountain passes hold the answers to the next chapter of a race with no obvious leader. What chances now for Andy Hampston? Now his team is down to seven.
I don't know, I hate to complain, but everything's coming apart.
East of the vineyards of Western France, over 145 miles from Brive-la-Gaillarde to Bordeaux, should have been a routine outing the day before the Pyrenees. Leading climber Raul Alcala came up alongside Stephen Roach to keep an eye on him on behalf of Andy Hatton and his teammates. And a day two for Marshall Gaillon to show off his new yellow jersey. But further back in the pack, Sean Kelly, the Irishman who is a serious challenger for this year's tour, was showing the signs of injury after a fall during the first 45 miles. Kelly remounted in the race and he pedalled back to the bunch where he stayed for some 12 miles. But then the pain from an injured shoulder, which is being diagnosed this evening as torn ligaments, started to prove just too much. Kelly was a real favourite for this year's Tour de France and he refuses to give in. But as the road started to climb, he could not grip the handlebars and the pain continued. Again, his team manager came alongside and asked him to stop. Sean Kelly's face says what everybody else was fearing. The damage to his shoulder is very, very serious indeed. Kelly is now 31. He's the world-ranked number one cyclist, and if he retired next year, he'd still be there because he's gained so many points in the world's top races. He's finished fourth and fifth in the Tour de France before, but his great ambition has been to win it. And here he's now stopped by the roadside. And Sean Kelly is forced to abandon the 1987 Tour de France, the first real casualty among the top contenders for victory.
You're right, Sean, you're right, boy. You're right, Sean. You'll be all right, Sean.
Meanwhile, up ahead in the race, Davis Finney was to become the first American to win a stage in this year's Tour de France. Avoiding the crash, Davis Finney won it in a sprint to the finish line in Bordeaux ahead of all rivals. And Davis Finney, a bright moment in an otherwise dismal week for the American team. So as you look at the list of Tour contenders, I'll remind you that we'll be in the Pyrenees to bring you all of the best racing from the Tour de France next Sunday. Until then, from Bordeaux, for Phil Liggett, I'm John Dockery. To grab the Tour de France by the throat. It is time for America's Hope to take charge of a race searching for a Terminator. Hampston's first lieutenant, Raul Alcala, is now a threat to win himself. And Dog Otto Lorenzen has exploded onto the scene as 7-Eleven has taken the continent by storm. Irishman Stephen Roach is still the race favorite, but is the pressure eating away at his nerves? The yellow jersey, the rider with the best overall time, belongs to Charlie Moté of System U. But two-time Tour champion Laurent Fignon still leads the Tour's most dominant team. In the Pyrenees, the Tour de France turns from a bicycle race into a spectacle. A drama being played out before hundreds of thousands of spectators. Out of the shadows of these mountains, the upstart Colombians, led by Luis Herrera, have emerged as real contenders with the ability to dominate this race. The Pyrenees is the place to take the offensive.
I think people will be attacked. I think the Colombians will be pushing it. And I hope it explodes. But I hope I'm on the right exploding in.
We at CBS Sports are proud to bring you the greatest bicycle race on earth. This is the Tour de France. Welcome to the stark beauty of Provence here in southern France, where today thousands are gathering for the most important race so far in this year's Tour. Hello, everybody. I'm John Dockery. And later this afternoon, right here on Mont Ventoux, the 164 survivors in this year's Tour will face the test they dread the most, an individual time trial over 20 miles up this mountain, all alone against the clock. And later today, we're going to bring you same-day coverage of this grueling race, almost certain to produce those riders worthy of wearing the yellow jersey 1 week from today in Paris. This year's Tour de France started in Berlin, the most distant start ever for a Tour. After 2 days of racing through the streets of the divided city and another 2 days in Germany, the Tour came home, crossing the border into France at Strasbourg. From Strasbourg, the riders headed west across Champagne country, where scorching heat was the common enemy. But for Tour favorite Stephen Roach, his problem was not just the heat. It was also his team working hard in sizzling temperatures to protect the yellow jersey worn by Eric Macklin. After all, weren't they supposed to be working for Roach? The big surprise of the early going was Mexican cyclist Raul Alcala. Riding for the American team, he would be a valuable ally in Andy Hampson's bid for the yellow jersey. The Tour then headed south, where Andy Hampson would face his first real test, an individual time trial. It was a disappointment, but still Hampson remained in contention. But he was no match for Irishman Stephen Roach, who solidified his status as the man to beat in this year's Tour. 7-Eleven's Dag Otto Lorenzen was a surprise, placing much higher than expected, giving the American team another weapon in their growing arsenal. But when it was over, System U's Charlie Moté, with a second-place finish in the time trial, wore the yellow jersey because he had the best overall time thus far. Then it's south into wine country, where System U maintained control of the pack. Team leader Laurent Fignon had taken on a new role, the protector's role, on a team so dominant that it could put even a domestique like Marshall Guyant in the yellow jersey, if only for a day. In Bordeaux, the Tour picked up speed, and a mad dash to the finish resulted in a serious crash. But out of the chaos came 7-Eleven's Davis Finney, with the only stage victory by an American to date, matching the one he earned last year. After Bordeaux, the riders see their first real mountains, first to the Pyrenees to test their mettle, and across the scorching plains of Provence. And then on into the Alps, where the men who would be champions separate themselves from those who simply ride bicycles for a living. From there, it's north to Paris and the finish, where the survivors will have completed their 2,524-mile journey in 26 days. And of the 207 riders who started in Berlin, a little more than half will see the finish in Paris before hundreds of thousands of cheering fans. And the final sprint down the Champs-Élysées serves as an escort for the man in the yellow jersey, the man who has beaten them all in their wild journey across France. And the question this year is, who will be the successor to last year's champion, Greg LeMond?
Second catch, Little Rose.
The reconstructed 7-Eleven team can now boast three serious contenders capable of mounting the winner's platform in Paris. No longer just team leader Andy Hampston. It could also be Raul Alcala, the climber from Mexico. The talk around this year's tour is the growth of 7-Eleven. One expert told me earlier this week that 7-Eleven is now one of the top seven cycling teams in the world, a quantum leap for the Americans.
Up on the top, and it rolls along, goes down a little.
The two Colombian teams, each with some of the best climbers in the world, hope to keep their singing going when the tour reaches the peaks of the Pyrenees and the Alps. But Stephen Roach still remains the most watched racer in this year's tour. The Pyrenees are next.